just as fast as you can. Taxi. Hello, I'm Nicholas Hoare for Vermont PBS. The Great Fire of London of 1666 demolished the entire city. It was extremely rapid, it was extremely destructive, but it did have one benefit, and that was that it created a completely clean canvas on which to rebuild the city using, ideally, some form of a grid a la New York and Chicago. It was not to be, despite the interventions of wonderful architects such as Robert Hooke, John Evelyn, Sir Christopher Wren. The fact was that the residents had other ideas, and particularly those who wished to build their houses again on the very sites that they had previously occupied. The result was, over time, the hodgepodge, the spaghetti that London is today. And it resembles, as the author of this book calls it, a Jackson Pollock. The labyrinth that is the interlocking web of London streets is simply stupefying, other than to one particular profession. And that is that of the taxi driver. Anyone who's visited London is extremely well aware of the elegance and frequency of the London black cab. It's an absolute fixture. It's an institution, has been for a very long time. But who are the people that drive these cabs, and how do they get the knowledge to do it? Where does it all stem from? The answer is contained in this little book that I'm holding in my hand, written by a cabbie himself called Robert Lordan. Robert Lordan is a typical London taxi driver, smart, razor whip sharp, and extremely astute when it comes to driving a person from A to B in the shortest possible fashion. But the knowledge, as it's called, has been evolving now for over a century, from before the First World War, to the point where it is now an extremely sophisticated chore that takes the student at least 4 years, sometimes five, to master. During that time, he appears, or she does, 27 to 30 times before examiners. The author here did it 27 times, in order to prove to the examiner that he or she has an absolute command of all 25,000 streets that radiate within a 6-mile radius of Charing Cross. Charing Cross is the epicentre of the studies that these poor people have to undergo. It is grueling, it is extremely taxing, very costly, because they're not otherwise gainfully employed, and once they get it, they never lose it. They are licensed for life. Robert Lordan thought it a good idea to describe what goes into this extraordinary procedure. And he's produced the book, which is subtitled Train Your Brain Like a Cabbie, in an effort to mend the gap. The curiosity factor is there, but the knowledge, as it were, is not. I'm going to take a couple of extracts from the book, and you'll get a whiff of what this is all about. By the eve of the First World War, the knowledge was beginning to resemble its modern-day counterpart, and at least one knowledge school run by the British Motor Cab Company was prepping candidates for the test. In April 1914, a report in the Manchester Guardian provided a comprehensive account of the process as it was then. Quote, every applicant for a license to drive a hackney carriage or taxicab within the area under the jurisdiction of Scotland Yard has, after proving his good character and passing a medical exam, to undergo a very severe test as to his knowledge of the streets and public buildings within that area. He is given a book with about 25 lists of questions, similar to those that are eventually put to the applicants. These lists consist of 18 point-to-point journeys, say from the Royal Exchange to the Elephant and Castle at Newington, or the Constitutional Club to Walham Green, and the applicant has to describe the exact route he would follow street by street. Today's cabbies and knowledge students would find this old description rather quaint. In the ensuing decades, the process has become infinitely tougher. The epicentre of the knowledge remains Charing Cross, but all told, it involves some 25,000 streets. Students are expected to learn the many thousands of points on these roads as well. These are officially classified as all streets, housing estates, parks and open spaces, government offices and departments, financial and commercial centres, diplomatic premises, town halls, registry offices, hospitals, places of worship, sports stadiums and leisure centres, airline offices, stations, hotels, clubs, theatres and cinemas, museums, art galleries and schools, colleges and universities, police stations and headquarter buildings, civil, criminal and coroners' courts, prisons and places of interest to tourists. In short, anywhere in London a passenger would like to go. Now, can you imagine trying to master this? The answer lies, as this wonderful gentleman himself describes it, in something called mnemonics, the association attached to words, places, things, and colour. And he has made, just as his colleagues have, an absolute profession out of understanding the nuances of this extremely ingenious, or should we say, method of photographic memory. He describes how this is achieved, and then he embarks on the actual knowledge. And this is an example of one of the 27 appearances, as they call it, the exams, that he went through. In all, I had to sit through all 27. Thankfully, my very first interview was with one of the kinder examiners, although she did make it clear that today will go easy on you, be warned, it will become tougher. And, oh my, was she ever right. First comes a point, and you must name the road it's on. We'll start, quote, at Grafton Square. I froze, and my spirits sank. For the life of me, I couldn't see it, and I've kicked myself ever since. It's just north of Clapham Common. No, sorry, ma'am. Okay, how about Maritime House? Suddenly it clicked. Maritime House is on Old Town Clapham, ma'am. Yes, and from there we'll run it to the Caesar Hotel. The Caesar Hotel is on Queen's Gardens, ma'am. Off you go. The idea now is to describe the most direct route between these two points, naming every turn and street name and describing the links between them in the knowledge's own special verbal shorthand. See the glossary at the back of the book. So my answer in this case, as the examiner peered over her glasses at me, was as follows. Leave Maritime House on the right, comply roundabout. Leave by North Street, follow Silverthorn Road, left on Broughton Street, right on Queenstown Road. Comply Queen's Circus, leave by Queenstown Road continued, forward Chelsea Bridge Road, left on Royal Hospital Road, right on Franklin's Row, left on St. Leonard's Terrace, right on Walpole Street. Cross the King's Road, forward Anderson Street, forward Sloane Avenue, forward Pelham Street, right on Thurlow Square. Left Thurlow Place, right Exhibition Road, forward Alexandra Gate, forward Serpentine Road, forward Serpentine Bridge, forward the Ring, forward Victoria Gate, left Bayswater Road, right and left Lancaster Gate, right Leinster Terrace, forward Leinster Gardens, right Queen's Gardens, and set down on Caesar Hotel on the left. The rest of that appearance is something of a blur, but fortunately I was awarded a C. This means I scored 3 points. The other marks available are A, 6 points, B, 4 points, and D, no points at all. To get their drop and progress to the next stage, a student must acquire 12 points within 7 attempts. Failure to do so results in the dreaded red line, and your assets are wiped out, and it's back to the start. As you can see, this book is a gem, And for anybody who is mathematically inclined or has a photographic memory or, dare I say, is riveted to find out more about what makes London streets tick, go no further. You can really have it all in one remarkable little book, which I commend hugely. The Knowledge, Train Your Brain Like a Cabbie by the irrepressible and very funny Robert Lordan. And on that very Londoner's note, good day.